I'm going to show up answers. Does anyone here conduct story mapping sessions today? Two? Okay, so the lovely people at Service Rocket have donated two $50 movie vouchers for Event, Grady Union, and BCC cinemas. And I'm going to ask some questions at the end, so keep this in mind because there's a couple of prizes to be won. So, and hopefully you're all going to learn something because not many of you are doing this today. Bit of background on myself. As Vince mentioned, I was an Atlassian formerly. I spent 5.5 years at Atlassian, and I headed over to San Francisco with Atlassian. My role at Atlassian, I spent most of my time working on Jira Agile, or formerly Greenhopper, Jira Agile, now called Jira Software. In San Francisco, I met a lot of Atlassian customers, and one of the customers that I met was Twitter, and they actually asked me to come along and join them and help them scale their engineering organization. It was kind of like a rocket ship. In the first 12 months that I was with Twitter, we added over 1,000 people. We added over 1,000 engineers. Not product managers, not designers, not sales, marketing, everyone else. We added over 1,000 engineers. So it was kind of like a wild ride. One of the things that was interesting during my time at Twitter was being part of the Agile Industry Consortium. It's a group of companies that have, generally speaking, over 4,000 or 5,000 employees, and they're doing Agile transformations at scale, and how do they approach that. If anyone's interested in Agile transformations at scale, I love talking about that stuff. Since I returned to Australia with my wife and a young daughter, I've started a business building products on the Atlassian marketplace, and I've actually started it with this gentleman down here, Dave Elkin, another ex-Atlassian, so I managed to rope him in, and he's kind enough to bring his family back from San Francisco as well. So, story mapping. The practice of story maps is for breaking down big stories as you tell them. This is from Jeff Patton. Jeff Patton was the person that introduced me to the practice of story mapping back in 2010. And if you're interested in like the complete history and all the detail on story mapping, and you want more detail than I give you tonight, then Jeff's got a book called User Story Mapping. That's a link to Amazon if you want to buy it and have a read for yourself. It is a great book. It is very dense. There's a lot of stuff in it. Essentially, my introduction to story mapping came with the rapid board. Has anyone here heard of the rapid board? A few. Yeah, okay, cool. So the rapid board was essentially taking the old Greenhopper and completely relaunching it into what you see in Jira Agile today. And we started that project, which was a multi-year project, we started that project using story maps and running story mapping sessions. So prior to running story mapping sessions, I had an ordered backlog, right? And not my entire backlog was not ordered, but certainly the top portion of my backlog was ordered. Ordered in terms of customer value, split up by sprints. And really over time, the backlog became a big mess. We had over 1,000 stories in our backlog for Jira Agile at the time. And it was really hard to get a sense for what are the things that are grouped together that represent certain user activities. And user story mapping takes that backlog and it takes the same user stories on that backlog and it gives them a bit more structure. And we're going to look at that now. But essentially you can see across the top, we've got some columns as well as rows, as well as the sequence of that work, whether it be sprints or fixed versions. The reason that this was so important, this story map, the reason this was so important was the rapid board, as I said, this project was a multi-year project. And we had to be able to sell this project to our customers, to our internal stakeholders. The story map is the backbone. And so the backbone represents those key activities that a customer is going to try and do. Now in this example here, I'm just saying, I want to purchase a movie on the Apple TV, I want to watch a movie on the Apple TV. So what are the things, broadly speaking, that I have to go? I have to select the movie that I'm going to watch. I have to purchase that movie. I might have some social actions around, you know, writing a review or referring that movie to friends. And obviously, I've got to watch the movie. Now, this backbone, it's not static, it's fluid. As the team generates this story map, much like reordering the product backlog, the team can reorder the backbone. what makes most sense? What is the chronological flow that the customer is most likely to go through as they interact with our product? Now, in this case, it's much more likely that I'm going to refer a friend to watch this movie or review this movie after I've actually watched it, after I bought it, after I've selected it. And so this chronology helps you and the team and the stakeholders understand what does that entire customer journey look like over time. From that backbone, we flesh it out with the user stories. So you can imagine if I wanted to select a movie, selecting a movie, I might have many different user stories for this activity. I might have browsing by genre, I might have browsing by popular, what are the latest releases. Now, there's a number of different user stories that I could think of here in the selection of the movie. In buying the movie, what are the different payment methods that I have? In watching the movie, what are the different actions I have? Can I skip forward, can I skip back, can I pause, etc., etc.? And same with social. And so what we're doing is not only are we fleshing out the backbone, but we're also listing the user stories that support that activity. The next key step that we undertake is ordering those stories. Much like we have the chronology of the user experience, we also want to make sure that those user stories are ordered in terms of customer value again. Just like you're going to order the backlog. And in fact, what you're doing here is that first pass on ordering the backlog. And after we've done that, we determine what is the sequence of our work. What goes in sprint 1, 2, 3, etc. What goes in our minimum viable solution that we're prepared to send out to our beta customers? You know, what is in the next release and what is in a future release? Or what is in release 2, release 3, etc. So we're splitting this story map horizontally as we go. Again, it gives us an indication of what we're going to release and when. So if you think of this in terms of Jira and your customer experience, the epics in Jira are what represent that backbone and those high-level customer activities that take place. The user stories form what is below each epic. What are the user stories that are supporting that customer activity? And so with that, really, I wanted to lead into a quick demo of a product that Dave and I have built. Ever since 2011, when we started running, late 2010, early 2011, when we started running these user story mapping sessions for Greenhopper and for the Rapid Board, I wanted a way to do that in Jira. At the time, it was all post-it notes on the wall, and it wasn't suitable for us, and there was a lot of rehandling as a product manager. In 2011, I wrote the first version of story mapping to Jira as a FedEx project, or it's now called Ship It at Atlassian. And so I've been eager to have it ever since. At Twitter, I ran over 50 or 60 of these story mapping sessions, and every time it was hard to pull all that information off the whiteboard, put it into Jira. It was hard to continue a story mapping session if we had to pull the post-it notes off the wall, move to another room and put them back up and try and continue that conversation. And it was extremely difficult when the team was distributed. And so that's what spurred Dave and I to build easy, agile user story maps for Jira. Okay, so we talked about this. This is an existing story map. This is not a blank slate. This is an existing story map for a talent acquisition application. At Twitter, one of the last story mapping sessions that I ran was actually for a product called Applicant Tracking System. And the idea was to take job applicants all the way from, you know, what is the start of that flow? How do they learn about that there's a job opportunity? All the way through to onboarding that employee and their first 90 days. So it was an entire flow, that application. And so what we have at the top here are Jira epics. Phone screens, on-site interviews, interview huddle, make an offer, acceptance, and so on and so forth. Below each of those, we've got the user stories that support each of these customer activities. Now, this story map is related to a Jira project. It's related to a Scrum board in this particular circumstance. And so I just quickly jump across, you'll see that this is a regular Teams backlog. They have these epics here. They have versions. And all of that information, that epic and the version selection, was all created and populated in the story map. So I have the ability with the story map to reshuffle my customer backbone. I have the ability to quickly create an epic. I'm going to do offboarding, because not only do we want to bring employees into the company, we also want to get rid of them at some point in time in the future, no doubt. So we're going to do offboarding. Oh, I beg your pardon. Someone's email address there. We can reorder this backbone, and indeed, under each of these activities, we can create a user story. So, for instance, the hiring manager may need to do a particular, they might need to make a letter of offer. I can send that letter of offer to the candidate. And like I mentioned before, we can drag and drop these stories to reorder these stories on the story map and also on the backlog.
So it preserves the rank.
It preserves the rank. It preserves the rank of the epics. It preserves the rank of the stories. And if I, for instance, if I wanted to change a story from the interview huddle across to making the offer, because I felt that was a better fit, I drag that across, and of course it preserves that relationship between the epics as well. Now I can quickly edit issues because, you know, in these story mapping sessions we might say, oh well, just make a quick note about acceptance criteria. On this one we need to make sure it works with such and such. So we can quickly edit the issues. And one of the things that's most valuable indeed when I talk about the applicant tracking system that we did at Twitter was how do we sequence that work over time. And the key thing for us was actually around the versions. We weren't talking about the sprints. It was a scrum team. They were doing 1 week sprints. But it was really around the versions. What is in their March release? What is in their April release? And so the ability to see your epics cut by version, and indeed the great unwashed backlog down the bottom here that we haven't yet scheduled. But if we wanted to schedule something, we could say we want to pop that right at the top. And this here, this is our 1.0. This is our first slice of the product that we want to take out to the customer. This is our 2.0. This is our second slice of the product that we want to take out to the customer, and it's pretty light on. Right? So we probably want to put a bit more stuff up there in our 2.0, otherwise the customer's not going to get really excited. And so it gives us this ability very quickly to build what is our releases over time and to see how are we tracking against our plan. Right? What does it look like over the coming months or over the coming years in some cases, and how do we track against that? And as I said, all of the changes that we make here, if we were to put TAL46 up into our 1.0 and it was under make offer, if we go across to our backlog and we look at 46, make offer to the candidate, it's 1.0 and it's part of that epic make offer. So everything is consistent from the story map through the backlog. The colors that we've chosen for the epics, which represent those customer activities, they're all consistent. Because as a product manager, I know that I need to scan down this backlog really quickly and see what is in, what is out of the release. Or what is in, what is out of a sprint, like how heavily weighted am I to one epic versus another. So folks, thanks so much for your time. I hope you learned a little bit about it.